2, 1. You are live, you are live.
Uh-oh. Good morning, everybody. I'm sorry, but this is completely unexpected. I will quote James Hendry this morning, there is no way it is going to rain. Well, as we can see, it is raining. Dave, if you would care to jump off and rescue the VR. My name is Jamie, and I'm going to chat to you about what it is we do whilst putting on the rain covers. I'm so sorry if I'd even thought there was the faintest possibility that this was going to occur this morning. I would have done it straight away. So for now, I'm out of communications with the rest of the world as Dave and I race whilst we talk to you to put the rain covers on. Oh, it just stopped. No, it's not going to stop. I don't believe this. We are absolutely drenched. It's one of those joys about if you ever, and you're watching us for the first time, had any doubt that this was live, perhaps we can convince you whilst we try and put on our rain covers, because the elements just come through and surprise us all. So, where are we coming to you live from? Whoever designed this rain cover bag didn't think so much about the necessary use of the bag. So, whilst it fits the rain cover in perfectly, the zip opening is a little bit small. Ha ha! Here we go. So, we've got these lovely canvas rain covers designed to redirect the rain. Do we think it's... Yes, we better just do this. I'm very sorry, everybody. We have got to just pop this on. Now, the reason why we are not jumping onto the back of the other vehicle whilst we do this, and whilst James is out and about, is that you will be with me for the next 3 hours. I hope you are all thrilled and excited to enjoy the pleasure of our company, Dave and myself. We've got exciting things planned for you. The reason that it is just us, oh my goodness, this is very difficult to do in the dark, half-blinded. Let me get rid of the skirt for now. This is Dave's skirt. He wraps it around himself so as to be fully protected from the rain. Oh, the joys of the live safaris. Where's the back of this thing? You got the back. Well done. Does it matter if we put it on upside down? Do we think it matters if we put it on upside down? I don't think so. Yep, okay, everybody, you're going to be blinded for the moment. Hello. There we go. Now hold on. This front is definitely not long enough. Here we go. This must be the front. That's right. That goes along here. At the moment, my vision is purely blinded by the presenter light. It is currently... Thank you. Oh, thank you, Dave. Oh, there we go. Dave's jumping off. I'm going to just jump off to pop the dashboard cover on. And of course, with all of that drama and dramatics, the rain has now stopped. But I think it's going to continue on. So let's just do this properly. Nevertheless, and don't forget while you watch us in this thrilling moment of putting on our rain covers, don't forget that you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, since we are interactive. Perhaps you would like to ask of me why it was that I predicted there was going to be no rain this morning. I've got to learn. I have got as much meteorological sense as the weatherman does, and I probably have about the same success rate. Here we go. Nearly there. Here we go. Rain's settling in again. Pop that on. Make sure it's on properly. Very efficient. I think Dave and I are the equivalent of a Formula One team in terms of effectiveness. And you've got to bear with me for one last moment, because I have sat on my earpiece cable and now I have to find it beneath the rain cover in the dark. Oh, it's pouring. What a surprise. Oh dear. Well, this is terribly unexpected. Okay. And I am back in the world of communication. And it is pouring with rain. Well, who saw that coming? Because I certainly didn't. How are you doing back there with the rain cover, Dave? This is fairly heavy rain. This is not a drizzle. This morning I thought it might maybe drizzle on us, but it hasn't. And I think this is too hard even for our rain covers. Oh my goodness, no, we're gonna have to go home. Ah! Escape, escape. I'm going to say farewell for now. Please stay tuned, the car won't start. There we go. I'm gonna say farewell for now. I've got to race back home. Oh my goodness, wasn't expecting this. We will keep you updated. Bye-bye, everybody.
Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning.
Sorry, this is the first time you've been seeing me, of course. We planned to do some filming today, but alas, the rain has kiboshed any plans that we had in that regard. Jamie is cold.
I'm freezing. James is the absolute gentleman that he is.
Yes.
Gave me a shirt and a jacket, so I am at least dry from the waist up. But I was very, very chivalrous of James. But contrary to anybody's expectations, I certainly didn't see this coming.
No.
And we started drive. As we started drive, it just came down. Poor Dave is sitting shivering at the back operating the camera. He also got caught in it. Thank goodness we got the rain covers on when we did, because it just came out of nowhere. And it just hasn't stopped.
No, it is still heaving out of the sky. It didn't seem to be stopping. Now, of course, the weather reports out here are more fictional than anything that J.K. Rowling has written. And so we don't know what's going to happen.
No.
But we do have some clips. Jamie, you had a special sighting yesterday.
I had an absolute first for me. James, I don't know if you've ever seen anything like this.
Not.
It was a baby, well, very tiny, speaks hinged tortoise that just arrived in the middle of our lion sighting, walked past both Sticks female's head, turned around, and then went and sort of cuddled up to one of them. And you don't just have to take my word for it, because it sounds so outlandish, so as not to be true. Why don't you have a look at the clip that we've prepared? Now just have a look at this and imagine the kind of day that this little tortoise is having. Tortoise making its way closer and closer to the next lioness. In fact, looking as though he's about to go and snuggle up to her. Oh, tortoise, what you doing? Where are you going? Clan Wild Fury, it is as much your guess as mine as to what happens next. Oh, sorry, Ellen, I was in the middle of answering your question. Ellen, I think it's more attracted to the warmth. I genuinely do. I think it woke up cold and it's looking for warmth. It is now finding itself under the leg. Well, this to me is an absolute first. I have never seen this in all my time in the bush. I have never seen a tortoise attempt to cuddle a lion. A most extraordinary moment. I've never seen anything like it. And that little tortoise was so lucky that the lions were not in the mood to chomp on it. They were very full and they were feeling obviously clearly lazy. They'd been wandering about all night. But the fact that they didn't, because lions do eat tortoises, they do play with tortoises, particularly in my experience, young males. But as it was, that little tortoise got incredibly fortunate. I don't know if it was looking for warmth. It was a very chilly morning. But I don't think so. I think it just suddenly, you know, when you're that big and that's the view of the ground that you have, maybe you just don't notice the lion until it's too late. And it did seem to sort of get to her leg and go, and freeze. And it was only when she rolled over and he was then exposed that he sort of hid out and scuttled off as quickly as possible. So the tortoise made a very lucky escape. Just to give you the update, the tortoise did get away. It was safe.
And quite strange, I think. I mean, because tortoises, like Jamie says, are eaten by lions. And, I mean, a little tortoise like that's pretty easy to bite and probably get through, even for a lion's jaws. So, yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, Laura was saying, would a tortoise have a natural fear of a lion, since she wouldn't have thought they might be typical prey? But I've seen lions eat and bug tortoises. The larger ones, as James was saying, the larger ones can sometimes get lucky. They retract into their shell, the lions scrape at it for a bit, maybe take off some of the keratin scales, and then they leave them alone. But a tiny one like that, I cannot imagine, would have the resistance to a lion's jaw.
No, not those giant canines.
No.
Yes. And one or two tortoise species, of course, most of which will be very excited to have a bit of rain about the place. The other being the leopard tortoise, which I guess is rounder and probably a bit more difficult to eat.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
That's a good point, actually.
I saw one yesterday, a leopard tortoise about that large. That's about a foot across. And I think a lion would really struggle to eat something.
Absolutely. I mean, they might go and investigate them for a little bit. So there's a lot of curiosity. Mm. The wonderful thing about that sighting was not just the tortoise, although I have to be honest, the tortoise absolutely hands down made my day, because I've never seen anything like that. The guests in the other vehicles were chuckling away to themselves. But the other magical thing about that Styx lioness sighting is that we had three of them together, and all three, to me, appeared to be pregnant, one more so than the others.
Not just fat.
The difference is not always that easy to distinguish with a belly full of buffalo, but nipples are starting to become more and more prominent. One of them even looked, as I left the sighting, even looked a little bit waxy. If you don't believe me, have a look at the clip yourself, and you can judge and see if you can spot the signs I was looking for. Look at that belly. Some pregnant ladies amongst this group, I suspect. Nipples starting to become prominent. Yes, sorry, girl. I'm not trying to be insulting. I wasn't calling you fat, I promise. Although you are looking very round-bellied. And when they do have their cubs, it will be a wonderfully exciting moment for us all. Of course, the lioness will remove herself from the pride, go and find a lovely denning. I think she looks pregnant. Look at that swollen, dark nipple there. There's a roundness that extends below the stomach and more towards the back legs. The next generation is on its way after all of the drama that we've experienced over the last few months. And she will hide her cubs away in a suitable denning area, maybe in a drainage line, maybe in a termite mound, wherever she decides to go. Wonderful news after everything that's happened here to finally see the evidence that the takeover by the Birmingham boys has been successful and that the next generation is on its way. Absolutely wonderful sighting to have, just to know that after everything, as I said in that clip, to know that after everything that the Styx lionesses and the Nkrumahs have gone through, to finally see the sort of the end result of a male takeover such as the one we've experienced in the last few months is definitely a special way to go about. Now, I'm no expert. I have no idea how far along they are. My guess is that the one lioness, the one that I called fat and who gave me a very dirty look for it, my guess is that she's a couple of weeks away from birth, but it is entirely a guess.
And we know, of course, that they have, or the Birmingham boys have produced offspring down in Mala Mala with the Mala Mala pride, so that's the first kind of sign of the solidification, if you like, of their takeover. The new kings are in town, and I think the Nkuhuma lionesses have been mating, one or two or three of them, so they too might be pregnant, and the Styx are going to produce cubs now. Really does issue in a brand new era in the lions of this area. So that's all quite fascinating. And quite interestingly, down to the south of Londolozi, there are three males who are known, I think that they're known as the Castleton males.
I have heard of the Castleton.
They are offspring of the Matimba males, who are also now at Londolozi, where they are sort of enjoying their dotage on a small postage stamp sized piece of land there.
That's a brilliant description.
It will be interesting to know what happens with the with those three Castleton males, because those Birmingham boys to me are small.
They're not huge lions at all. Yeah. I mean, there's five of them, which helps, but they're not big.
Nothing like the size of the Matimbas, and if those Matimba offspring grow up the same size as their fathers, and maybe, now this is a spanner in the works, Junior returns one day and joins up with his siblings from a brother from another mother. I mean, would be rather fascinating to see what happens.
All I can think of is it is exactly like a lion soap opera, the possibility. And I know a lot of you have been keeping us updated on the presence of Junior, wondering about the Kruger. And apparently his most recent antics included attacking a sort of very sad, dying female hippo and the calf defending it. It was quite a sad sighting.
Do we know it was Junior?
It looked like him. I'm going to leave that up to those of the viewers who feel that they know him the best. Obviously, the most accurate way of identifying a lion is that you can have a look at the whisker spot patterns and compare them, which is difficult when you've got screenshots versus, you know, if you don't have enough resolution on them. But it's entirely possible. But before we leave the topic of the Styx females, we had a question from a Christopher in Washington about whether or not, if the females gave birth, do you think we should...
Just quickly want to show you this. Giant moth.
It's so beautiful.
And we don't know what it is. No idea. But, you know, he's warmed up now because he's been sat on my hand. And, of course, that's made him a lot more active than he would have been otherwise.
That size, and he's velvety.
Doesn't really know. I think maybe a she.
Maybe a she.
Aren't the she's the ones without the antenna?
Yes. And those eye-like markings, not quite the typical eye of an owl moth, but
anyway, I'm gonna
really
put
truly
him back.
Beautiful. Yes, I think maybe return to its original position. We see some stunning moths coming. I've seen some stunning moths since the rains coming through, attracted. And, of course, the rain's bringing all manner of insects. I had a charmingly large scorpion in my bathroom that all of a sudden alerted me to its presence by hissing next to my feet, which I really appreciated. I really appreciated that warning.
Your bare feet.
Yes, my bare feet.
Should be reiterated.
Yes, my bare feet. I was very, very comforted by the fact that I got a warning sound before anything else. Sorry, Christopher, back to your question about whether or not the Styx lionesses, if they give birth at the same time, will den in the same place. In my experience, even lionesses from the same pride that give birth in different time, or at the same time, have denned in different areas, but that doesn't mean that they don't den in the same area. James, I don't know if you've got any...
I think that most likely they'll give birth alone. Mm. I mean, they might then come out of their dens and join up slightly earlier, because they do move their dens every so often.
Yep.
Maybe instead of the standard issue, I think it's 6 weeks before they're introduced to the pride, that might happen slightly earlier.
That makes sense. We know that females allosuckle, so lionesses, they will feed their cubs plus their sister's cubs or others. Now, it'll just be interesting to see how this situation plays out and, of course, where we decide to, where they decide to choose as a den site. I think if I had to guess, I would say somewhere around Chitwa, just judging by the movements of the Styx females themselves. But we'll just have to wait and see. Exciting prospects. Mm. The big cats are giving us wonderful hope for little cub sightings in future.
And of course, there's nothing cuter in the world than a lion cub, not even a leopard cub, and I know that is going to offend many of you.
That was a bold claim. That was a bold statement there.
A lion cub is just something very special. Becky, you had a question about the bump on the elbow of that lioness, and you wanted to know what that is. Becky, nobody's really sure. There is a theory that it is part of bovine tuberculosis, which we know does affect lions, and so it could well be a swelling from bovine TB. We're also not sure exactly what kind of effect that has on lions. There was a great panic many years ago that the lions of the Kruger National Park were on the verge of extinction because of bovine tuberculosis. But unless there's a sort of, as far as I understand it, unless there's a serious sort of nutritional defect in the lion, unless they are seriously stressed out and can't get enough to eat, much like with the buffalo, the bovine TB just kind of lives in the body and doesn't seem to have a huge effect.
That's exactly what I've observed with buffalo in particular, and it makes sense to me that it's going to be something that carries over to the lions. But the difference is, of course, the buffalo in this drought, this incredible drought, the buffalo are going to suffer that nutritional defect, whereas the opposite's going to happen with the lions. They're going to be successful. They're going to have access to all kinds of carcasses that have passed away from starvation. They will be fine. The buffalo, on the other hand, you'll probably see more and more of them start to show serious symptoms of TB. And I noticed that in Kruger as well.
Starting to cough.
Starting to, they're dripping blood from the nose.
Okay.
And
That's interesting. All right, everyone. We're going to give it another probably 10 or 20 minutes before we think about going out again. If it has sort of stopped raining, not quite. We'll give it a little bit more time because the last time it stopped raining, Jamie went out and 3 seconds later she was soaked again. So we'll give it a little bit of time and then we may or may not go out depending on how the weather is. But until then, otherwise we'll see you this afternoon at 4 o'clock.
I have to be honest, I would prefer to stay dry this time around, but let's see.
Fair enough.
We're going to give it a bit of time and just see if it decides to return to all of us. All right. Well, thank you for those loyal viewers sticking with us. Have a wonderful day, and we'll see you later.
Bye-bye.
Cheers.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.